I'm going to, for those that have seen me speak before, you know that I like talking about property. 25 minutes is going to be a massive challenge, so we are going to go fast. Take notes, or Patricia is going to record it, and then we'll put it on our YouTube, just because I will need to go fast, because I have 30 slides and I cut them down from 50. Let's do some maths. There are roughly 40 people in the room. On average, 1 in 10 people will work with you, and on average, the fundraising total that they will give you is 50 grand. So, do the maths for me, Alex. 40 people in the room, 1 in 10 will work with you, so how many people are going to work with you?
4.
On average, they will give you 50 grand, so how much money is that raised out of this room tonight?
200.
How many people have collected every single business card from the room? Shame on you! And then 40 people divided by 200 grand divided by 40 people is how much is each business card worth to you as a business loan? 5 grand? Is it now worth collecting the business cards? Yes. And I'll tell you that my entire maths, and because I'm a complete statistical geek, is now I don't mean it's worth gifted cash, it's worth fundraised cash. £169.38 out of my entire database. I know that because I do the maths. So again, is it worth collecting business cards? Because you just don't know where relationships are going to go, so you might as well start opening some doors. So let's go fast. Property, it is, I'm creaking. I should keep creaking. It's kind of simple, isn't it? It's definitely not easy. I don't know how many sleepless nights I've had. I never pretend that it's straightforward. But it's simple. We find it, we fund it, and we farm it. And today, we're going to very briefly and rather fast talking about funding it. Please do. We've got the Dream Scottish team. And if you want some free stuff, we produce a lot of free content, mainly because I like talking about property. Also because when I started, I used to come into rooms like this terrified because I didn't know anything. You know, I'd write yield equals and I'd write the equation in my purse and think, okay, I know something. In fact, I saw Stephen when I was first beginning in Bristol and I was kind of like, wow. I still remember his strategy now. In fact, I still have your advice printed out and written on my door in my home office, which is thank you very much. And that was 6-7 years ago, and something like that. So we do a lot of kind of what you might call give back. We do lots and lots and lots of YouTube videos. For us, it benefits us because people can see that we tell the truth and we're straight speaking and we say how hard it is. And I'm on properties after having worked out in the gym. And you know, there's no glamour and there's no fancy pants. So if you want to have a look at YouTube videos, we've got 250 or so. We also do free 101 lessons, all the screw ups and all the lessons I learned from my first 100 deals. And then we've got some other stuff if you want to work with us. Please do, Scottish Dream Team. So today, I'm going to try and crack through all of this stuff. Let's keep going. So how do I find them? I've just told you. Here. So you collect business cards, you know the maths. I don't go, hey, can you give me some money? Because that's not what I'm interested in. I'm only interested in working with people I like. I'm only interested if it benefits them too. I raised £600,000 to buy my first portfolio, and then I jumped out of my job. At that point, I paid what I would now call as an exorbitant rate of interest, which was 12%. So 72 grand in my first year to other people. So other people really benefited from me, but I also really benefited from working with them. So places like this where I simply ask people what they're interested in property, what's your objective, what's your time frame, how much is your pot? I think he wants me to move on. See whether it's an appropriate thing for us to meet. Because if it's my work is not going to benefit somebody else, there's no point meeting. And if their kind of situation isn't going to benefit me, I might want to meet because I really like them, but there's no point meeting if I'm running a fundraising campaign and the purpose of the meet is to raise funds. So for me, did you just punch that on? You cheeky buggers. Backtrack. Here we go. What's your objective? What's your time frame? And how big is your pot? And you'll ask that question within 2 minutes. Now, what does that tell me? It tells me what somebody wants to achieve. And often it's not like I want to make so much money. It's kind of, I want to send the kids to a private school, or in England, because I'm from Glasgow actually, a public school. Or I want to buy a camper van, or whatever the heck it is. So figure out how much it costs, what it is that what they want to do. Find out when they need to achieve it by. And then find out what their current pot is. And if you do the maths, that will give you their APR, won't it? You know, if they've got 100 grand and they need to make 20 grand in a year's time, that's a 20% interest rate, isn't it? Well, I'm going to pay 20%. So I can't deliver fully to that, but potentially I'm able to do, maybe able to do some of it. So by asking those questions, your objective, your time frame, and what's the pot that you've got to achieve your objective, it allows you to go, well, is there a fit here? You know, because if there is a fit, you know what, guys, those folks that earn interest from me, we're very lucky. That's wonderful. So figure out whether this is a good fit and just use these questions to determine what people want to achieve and whether your projects can mathematically deliver to their needs. Go for it, drinking. Thank you. So for the first step, prove your credibility. Now, because you're new, like you guys are just starting, don't worry about that. I raised 600,000 quid after doing two projects. People are gonna judge you for you first, and then they're gonna decide whether they're gonna work with you on a project. So one of my mentoring clients at the moment, one of my investors, in fact, my investor told him to come and mentor with me, one of my investors taken me aside and said, that lad, I've completely decided to work with him. I just need to see a good project now. So they're going to entirely judge you for who you are, what they perceive your values to be, and whether you've got common sense, whether you've got good hard drive, whether you're honest, you know, whether you're open book, and then the deal will come second. And that's, I think, inevitably, when it's personal relationships like this, it's very much the case. So I proved my my deliveries, if you like, with these two first deals. So when we were talking earlier, I wasn't really giving you an easy run of it, was I? When you were saying, I want to do this, and I'm like, mate, you know, you can do it now. There's no need to do it later and wait for yourself. You're looking at getting mortgages, and I'm like, go raise money. You can do it now. Because people will work with you if they feel there's a good fit and if the project will deliver back to their objectives. So for us, we do deal sourcing. We do a lot of buy to keep. I've got a very substantial portfolio. Must be crazy. I don't actually need to work. I work 2 hours a fortnight with my lettings team. That's the only technical work I need to do now. But I'm kind of running around because I really love property. And then we do a lot of buy and sell. Hey, well done. So for you guys, if you haven't got maybe the numbers that we have now behind us, well, what's your background? When I started, I used to show people my personal mortgage. I used to show them my payslip. I showed them my business plan, 16 pages though it was, you know, and I was completely terrified. I would actually have coffees always at my kitchen table so they could see my house, they could meet my children, they could figure out how well or badly behaved they were. So they're really understanding kind of who I was as a person. And then I would look at my transferable skills. So if you don't have many property skills at this stage, what transferable skills do you have? You know, project management, financial capabilities, marketing skills, sales skills that you're going to transfer into your project. So don't wait for permission. If you're going to launch a fundraising campaign, look at yourself professionally and figure out what skills do I have that are going to be successful in property, and those are the skills that you talk through with your potential investors. We got this going, haven't we? So this is where we're at so far. In fact, it's 204, and I think he phoned me today. We're moving office today as well, that he's got another one in. We're very conservative in our value. We're known for being very careful. In the first 200 deals, I think we got four or five, what I might call wrong, 2.5, 5, and 1 10 grand out. The rest, like 1-2 weeks ago, sold. We told the investor, I think it was 235, and it sold for 256, 750. We just go, yeah, we know that. So we're very, very cautious on our valuation. And as a result, that gives really good credibility. You know, our investor was quite pleased, and we were like, oh yeah, uh-huh. Because we're always undervalue, so that when there's a property screw up, they don't even realize they've been cushioned for safety's sake, but we've been cushioning them. So we've had a purchase price of 30 million quid before refurb. So that's 50 million quid before refurb we did in 5 years. So now we have credibility. Didn't when I started with two properties. So very, 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 very briefly, these are my exact figures, which is wonderful. That, it was bought at 203, it was called the Smelly Dog House because I'm not even going to go into description. Thank God we don't have much time. Mm-hmm. But suffice to say, we had to replace all floorboards in the bottom house. And it was valued at 330 now. Now, because I bought in the recession, so I've never really thought about capital growth. Now that's 475. And I only bought that 4 years ago. How good is that? So, not bad. Next one. Mm-hmm. And then, oh, there you go. And if you are one of my mentoring clients and you give me flowers, honey, they're going straight into a property and then straight back out again. Because so it's fine. It's, you know, perfectly adequate. Nice 5-bed HMO. Next one. And then Ellsworth, just a little tiddler. We bought this one from auction. Bought it for 103. Actually met the woman who sold it. It was her mum going into her home and she wanted security for her mum. She was lovely. And we sold it almost immediately with 11 days. So if you can do a show, a couple of projects, that will give some credibility. You can tell that's a lower kind of social economic because the white goods get moved in and out. So a quick tip for buy to sell, do not write with white goods. I've done it. It's roughly £330 a word, isn't it? Because you move, if you're doing buy to sell, you move those white goods in, ba-boom, 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 five properties and then whap it into your sixth HMO. I have done it where I forgot that I wrote with white goods and I had to return £1,000 worth of white goods and I was kicking myself, so don't do that. Let's keep going. So, you find them at events like this and you just tell everybody what you're doing. You don't say, you know, give me money, but you might talk about a property you bought for £203,000 that got revalued by a RIC surveyor 6 months later for £330,000. They might be interested. Just might be. You know, making it over a grand a month. They just possibly might think, ooh, tell me. And you're kind of just listening for their voice to perk up. Do you know what I mean? It's like Dr. Spock ears. You know, the tone just changes slightly. And then just have a chat. What are you looking to do? What's your objective? What's your time frame? And what's your pot? If you're interested, why don't we have a coffee? So don't chat there and then, because this is just a bump into each other. Make it an official, agendaed, you know, rimmed conversation that we'll have a chat a week on Tuesday about that, shall we? Because then you know and they know what you're there to discuss. So it's kind of got an official topic to it. So, yeah, I'll keep going. So what's critical to get to a yes? Pace. This is not something that happens overnight. This is not a quick fix at all. This is about building up relationships. And it's very important. We've been through the whole cycle with investors now. And I only want to work with people I like. I only want to work with people that go, oh, the joys of property when a little bit bump happens, because bumps happen in property. I don't want to work with people who are kind of a little bit high maintenance and I won't work with them, absolutely not. And pace on your side as much as their side will allow you to see who they are and for them to see who you are. So everybody, if I can speak quite frankly, with the figures we're producing, everyone's nice to me. That doesn't actually mean anything. Are they nice to my team? And often, they're not. Or not often, sorry. But the ones I don't want to work with think, excuse me, Susannah, Susannah, Susannah. And you literally get that in meetings. It's fascinating. Well, I'm not going to work with somebody like that because actually the person you're shoving aside is as valuable as you think I am. So really important. Relationship fit. Do your values match theirs? Do their values match yours? And again, one of the ways we test it out is we held Investor Day every 2 weeks. And again, forgive me if I can use your shoulder, but Susannah, 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 the prima donna that pushes aside others when you're in a group is the prima donna you want to bring out before you even start working with them. Sorry, you're the one that's been shoved aside. And and so just look at whether you want to hang out with these guys and whether they want to hang out with you. Do you have other options? People get to a difficult position with investors if they're the only option, because at that point the investor may start saying, could you please start jumping? And the only answer is, how high? No, I didn't jump out of corporate life to put up that kind of crap. And then understand what they really want to achieve. Not, do you want to make some money, but what is it that's important to you, the investor, that I can look to deliver to? You know, for some of my large, you know, multimillionaires who've made money and popped out the other side of either corporate life or selling their companies, yeah, they want return on capital employed, of course they do. But they also want security, and they also want some interest. Because, of course, I mean, fun and excitement. Because one minute, you're in the middle of a company, and you are so meaningful, and the next minute, you're off on the golf course, and there ain't much excitement going on there. Might be a chill, but where's the buzz? So for some of my guys, it's actually being part of a buzzing company that they can come into, have a brilliant coffee, and they go, oh my God, thank God I don't work as hard as her, and then they go home again. And make sure the process for them is very, very clear. So there, it's about leading. Don't say, well, you could do this or that. Say, this is the process with which I work. You can lend me money or we can do joint ventures. Here are the legal agreements of both. Can I talk you through the process so that you understand it? And therefore, you're leading, but you're also making it very clear. Lovely. Pre-meet, how much and how long are they looking to work with you? So that would be the first meeting. Their due diligence. For me, I'm entirely open book, and it is frightening how little due diligence investors do. I mean, it's scary frightening. I always kept my private borrowings to under £1 million because I always wanted to go through the washing machine and back out again. I could have raised absolutely millions, because people trust me. It's only because I have that latch that I always made sure the money bumbled through again. I've only ever had one investor do thorough property due diligence on me. I'd give a case study, and they came to lunch with the quantity surveyor who said, "Can I see your receipts, please?" And while we were having nice cheese and grapes and ham and all the rest of it, it was a quite bizarre thing. The quantity surveyor sat there and added up all my receipts. And do you know what? They added up to exactly what I said they'd add up to. One out of all the hundreds of people I've worked with. But my thinking is, you must be open book, you must provide everything, and it's their choice on how much debt they go into. Then they go into some interim communication. So for example, if you don't have legal agreements, do you think anyone's going to take you seriously? So make sure you've got legal agreements in advance, because you're going to want to send them over. And then the second, so this time I'm not going to shove you away. Say we meet for first go, because you've got some money, you've got some objectives, and you know what you want to do, and I think that what I do could suit you. We have the first meet. At the end of the first meet, I'm not there going, "Can I have your money, please?" because I don't know you well enough. We still get to know each other. But what I'll do is say, "Shall we meet in 2 weeks hence?" So all I need to do on the first meet is put a second time in the diary. Now, if you've decided on that first meet, no way, not hope in heck, that's fine, you just cancel the meeting. But it means that you and I both know that you've gone away to mull it over, probably to ask me for a bit more due diligence, and then we're back to have a second meet, which may or may not be a decision point. So put the second meet in the diary at the end of the first meet. Lovely. This is rocking. You've got a team thing going on. Oi, back. Thank you. So understand their objectives. Definitely, in my view, this is just my own thoughts. Can't give you legal advice, just tell you my experience. Don't take all the money, particularly if they've inherited it. You are a risk. Property is a risk. I've never, ever lost anyone any money yet. But nonetheless, you know, could you imagine if somebody's grandmother passed them down some money and that project went south? How awful would that feel? So for me, anyone that's ever taken an inheritance, I've said, well, put a fifth of it in and let's just test out the relationship. I don't want that huge responsibility of inherited money, particularly. Paperwork definitely closes the deal. Remember your conversion rates. Remember, 1 in 10 will work with you. 50 grand is the average. So you know what's sitting in this room, and you need to collect those business cards. And from the first meet, 1 in 2 will say yes, and 1 in 2 will say no. And that's perfectly okay. And make it easy for them to say no, because we're very British. We don't like asking, and we don't like saying no. But just make it a comfortable thing. If you want to, great, and if it's not quite right for you, that's totally okay as well. And maybe you want to watch me longer to make sure I'm going to be successful. One of my early investors, he took 18 months, and we had quite a good relationship. My friend went, what's taking you so long? Because I'm quite straight speaking. He went, "I just was watching to make sure you were successful." You know, smart guy. Right. So remember the stages. Send them information, ask. We're very, very British, aren't we? We don't want to ask. I mean, it's mortifyingly embarrassing. So I used to have a system, 2 spoonfuls of Nutella, 1 phone call to ask. 2 spoonfuls of Nutella, 1 phone call to ask. Whatever your reward system is, like a hamster, just reward yourself for every time you've asked. And then they decline, and that's totally okay. So make it easy for them to decline. They pledge. I've only once now had somebody who pledged not follow through. And will I ever work with that person again? No. I didn't make it difficult for them, but I do what I say. So somebody that said they were pledging and didn't follow through is not somebody whose values I want to work with again. So that's okay. No, you can go pledge and mid to off you go, but I'm not going to work with people I can't rely on. And then they invest. joking. So this is the kind of paperwork I used to have. So business plan, case studies, the before, the after. Do you know what? Of all the paperwork I ever produced, the things that would persuade my investors the most were my slightly tatty, printed off A4, before photos, after photos. Honestly, that made the difference. And then as we grew to scale, so we kind of run about 30 projects at any one time now, as we grew to scale, it was actually having them on site that made the difference, because they can kind of see and feel it. And on site, on a finished buy to sell, was kind of like, yeah, nah, seen a house. On site, when the project was ongoing, was when the body language got really excited. Because fewer people have been on site to see stuff that's, you know, knackered, than have been on to, you know, everyone's seen plastered walls, everyone's seen carpeted floors. They're all right, but you want to take them to shows where you can see the sky, and then take them back 2 months later and show them the finished project. And then contracts and the result table. It works for me, but make sure you've got your contracts in advance so that they can understand contractually how you might be working together. Make sure you advise legal advice in writing to them, and make sure you have two types of solicitors. You've got a commencing solicitor to buy your properties and a commercial solicitor to do your commercial contracts. So I can't give you legal advice, I can just tell you what I know and what processes we use. So make sure you have written legal agreements. We have the same legal agreement for everybody. So there's no messing around. And if somebody wants to change terms, no. They can decide not to work with us, but we have exactly the same terms for everybody, and therefore everybody knows that we're being fair. And RX1 is kind of what, you know, I'd say it's the kind of hat. It restricts the property. You can't sell it or refinance it. Generally, depending on what we do, for joint ventures anyway, we put an RX1. Usually our partners own the property, so that feels quite safe for them. Because I'm not going to run off with a house that I don't. Well, I'm not going to run off with a house, full stop. But our partner will own the property. It'd be quite heavy, wouldn't it? But our partners will own the property. We will put an RX1 on it, so they can't sell it without our permission. So they can't run off with their property, with their profit. And then the only money I will touch of a joint venture, which is you get together, you find a discounted house, you renovate it, and you sell it again, and you split the profit. We will not start the refurb until the partners have put over into our bank account the refurb money. So in terms of risk, there's a relatively smallish risk for our partners. They're risking the refurb money, but they've already got a discounted property. And they've checked me out, and we've spent 6 months getting to know each other, so we're not going to run away with some bricks and mortar. Be aware of 13.3. 13.3, I think, is an absolutely good thing. It came in on the 1st of January 2014. It is there for variable opportunities, i.e. buy to sell, which in essence, for me, is joint ventures. I don't do buy to keep, because Beyonce, if you like that, you should put a ring in it, and I'm not married to anybody, so I'm not going to keep with anybody except for myself. So I'm going to do repeatable buy-to-sell projects with a start, a middle, and an end with people. So 13.3 is about variable opportunities, which buy-to-sell properties are, because we can do as much research as you like. We do 45 pieces of research on every property, which is why we're strong. But we can't actually say the exact penny it's going to sell for. Therefore, it's variable. So you've got to do some compliance around that. In the fundraising pack that we have on my website, we actually show you the compliance that we do. We can't give you legal advice, but I'm pretty sure it's really robust. We get them to do the self-certification. We identify why it's fair and appropriate. So for example, even if somebody was high net worth, so 100 grand income or quarter million pounds of assets and not in their own family home or insurance or pension, if, for example, you know, very sadly, they'd experienced a death in the family, it's still not appropriate to work with that person until you judge honestly and clearly that they've passed the grieving phase and now can make a good decision again. So it's both, are they in a limited company or are they high net worth? Is it a fair and reasonable opportunity? And is there anything in their life that might prevent them from making a really sensible investment decision? And then what we do on top of that is we track back the relationship, really to show we're no boiler house. You know, we take 6 months to figure out whether we want to work together, whether they want to work with us. Oh, looks like I better go on then, doesn't it? Now this is the area, if you're raising private finance, you will fall down in, and I don't mean this in any critical way. It is the area we often fall down in again, and the reason is you're busy. Like, you're ridiculously busy. And there is a mismatch usually between what your investor wants, which is probably daily communication, and what you are able to give or even comfortable in giving. So the way that we do this is, certainly for our source, actually sourced, you know, 45 million quid's worth of property for 30 million quid. Can you imagine how many people want to speak to me? Everybody, all the time. And so what we do there is we put in 3 1.5 hour sessions a week in his diary, And then anybody phoning in going, I want to speak to Ash now. We go, okay, let's put you in the diary. And we explain in advance our process, which says, do you want to talk to Ash or would you like him to get deals for you? You know, so we understand you're going to be minorly frustrated by the limited amount of communication you can have, but actually the reality is we're here to do a job and you need to let us do our job. So we do newsletters, emails, and phone calls, property tours, regular coffees. I try and put them in groups as much as possible for efficiency's sake, just because we're quite scaled up now. But you need to be clear in advance to your investors. You're probably going to be frustrated by the level of communication because I'm too busy doing the job. I will try my very best. We also now do Dropbox, so we put our costs, we put photos, we'll go on site and do a quick video, and that makes your communication a wee bit more efficient. So be aware that that's the one area that communication, your investor will want more communication than you're genuinely able to give, because if you communicated to the level they wanted, you wouldn't actually be able to manage the project. So just highlight that in advance to them if you're doing a joint venture, so that when they feel that, they go, ah, she warned me of this. Okay, I got it. Right, systems. Oh, I'm a total geek. A total geek. Everything is on every single system in my business, and all my five departments is on Drive, and every single system is a spreadsheet so that I can see where my entire business is at any one point. That's buy to sell, which is the development, sourcing, lettings, education, or head office. Everything. I can see everything, single thing, and we also have KPIs. But for investors, you need a front-end relationship management system, aka Excel spreadsheet. When did you meet them? What's their name, their second name? Where do they live? When did you last meet them? Before the general mass. And then who's your hot list? Again, the whole thing. And then what was the conversation and next steps? And then you need either veto because you've decided not to work with them, or they've declined, so they're not working with you, or they've actually moved and into deciding to pledge and then invest with you. So be very aware of how frequently you've actually communicated with people. You can have a fancy CRM system all you like, but do you know what? I've raised millions with using Excel spreadsheets, but well-designed Excel spreadsheets. You can buy them or you can just create them. Keep going. This is good.
When you had apps there, that's a system, isn't it?
It is a system.
Yeah, that's on, yeah.
Yes.
Good.
But frankly, I use Excel. You know, it works fine for me. And because the numbers of people you need to work with is not actually that high in the grand scheme of life. If on average each person will pop in 50 grand, you know, you only need 10 for half a million, 20 for a million. It's not huge, is it, really? You don't really need ACK for 20 people, account management. So JV partners, we've talked about financial safety. Be aware of other ways that you might secure people's money. If you're borrowing, perhaps you might put, you'll definitely have an RX1, you might put a charge, a floating charge, a second charge, personal guarantee. If they're lending you the home, I have one guy that lends me 600 grand a year every year. I don't really need him anymore, but I actually really like the relationship. He built a company, sold it for about 5 or 6 million quid, and I actually really enjoy his brain across my business. So I kind of, these days I just like working with him for who he is. So do you notice the meaning for me about working with him is not really the money anymore, it's more his brain, because I've got all the property I need in the world, and yeah, okay, I'll buy another block of flats and that's fine, but it's more because I want to have some conversations with them. And the flats just come and you go, okay, that's fine, you know, let's have the chats and then we buy the flats. But just be aware of what way you might want to put some security, and talk with your commercial and your conveyancing sister to make sure you're putting adequate security in for your partners and adequate security in for yourself as well. So for example, just going back there, I did hear of a case quite recently where they put in an RX1, which is the restriction, and they wrote to their lawyer and told them to lift the restriction, but they didn't say, subject to me being paid my share from the joint venture partnership. So that became, wasn't us, but it became a little bit of a dispute. So just be aware that you also need to be, with the odd 2% of people who are officially nutters, 98% of people are really cool, be aware that you also need to be slightly careful in these large financial arrangements to make sure your interest is protected, as are your partners. So, how'd you start? Let's have a coffee. What's your time frame? What's your objective? And what's your pot? And if you feel that your work can deliver to their needs, and their situation might be able to deliver to your needs, such as it's genuinely mutually benefit, well, have a coffee, you know? Sounds like the stuff we do might be able to help you in what you're looking to achieve. Why don't we have a coffee to talk about it? Shall we meet a week on Tuesday? I don't go, hey, let me pitch to you straight away, because I just met you. I don't know who you are. I don't know, you know. And the chances are that meeting will be 10 minutes about the opportunities you've got, and an hour and 20 minutes about who you are, who they are, where they come from, what their family's like, what life is like. Really, it's a getting to know you gut feel scenario. And really, the deal is done on based on whether you get to know each other and decide you're starting to like each other. And it'd be 6 to 9 touch points. Of the touch points, I don't mean banging into each other by a mistake, and I definitely don't mean emails. I mean phone calls, meetings, lunches, coffees. We've actually closed our investment group now, but I put people together in groups for the precise, you know, let's see what people are like in a group. Okay. But those are kind of organized meetings. So 6 to 9 times you're going to meet up. And follow through is vital. It's brilliant to be here tonight, but actually all of the work in running a fundraising campaign is about following up and following through. Downside to raising private finance takes about 30% of your time. I know, because I've done a time emotion study, of course. So 30% of your time is fairly hefty when you're busy. Oh, there you go. I've never done this so fast in my life. I just wanted to be respectful of the time given. This is normally number of hours, and I actually do how to raise private finance on a short workshop for 4 hours, short, and a weekend. So I tried to pick out the best for you. So some of the ways you can work with us, we got some. Has anybody bought our property packs? No.
Like a couple.
Have you got? Yes.
Of course.
What do you think?
I think it's very good indeed. Yeah, they're very good.
Straight speaking.
Yeah.
Detail.
Yeah. Indeed.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Very to the point.
We do have a we do have some intro workshops. We do have a mentoring group, and you can volunteer as part of our red crew if you want to hang out with us. Is there anything else?
Okay.
Oh, is that my last one?
Yeah. Oh, well, thanks.
There you are.
Brilliant.
That was the fastest run through in history. I have
yeah.
never gone so fast. So, any questions? Yes, I know. Stuart's often our timekeeper at mentoring. He's timekeeper brackets failed, because I will talk for history. Any questions on really crazy?
Yeah, we've got time for questions. Must be lots.
Go on.
By the way.
That's brilliant. Really interesting.
Well, Richard has told me that we should hang out together for years, so very nice to meet you. We'll hang out. Go on. Who wants to raise some money? No way.
Well, the pack, also the pack itself is it's got, well, it's a big initiative. It's got the actual agreements, joint venture agreements, and the loan agreements you've got. So I think it's explained quite well. I went through that quite a lot.
Good.
Summarised. There's a lot to take in here.
Yeah.
About who owns what, where the risk is, and where. As you say, you're probably hopefully buying properties that are, the discounts.
Yes.
They've got the money, the risk for them is a small risk, but I suppose with the experience you've got and what you've been doing over this period of time, it's mostly in the southwest, right? Yes.
Everything in Bristol. It has, apart from one property in London, which was very interested, Richard, in, oh sorry, not London, in Scotland, because my son lives in that, so it's my only loss-making property, because that's motherly love. And he lives 15 minutes away from my mum and dad, because he's at college there. Everything else is 17 minutes time of my office. And that's it. And we won't go beyond 17 minutes for efficiency for either running the renovation or then doing the tenant viewings and inspections and such like. So everything is within Bristol. Please do.
Yeah, I mean, I'm just someone who's only recently bought a couple of flats and I'm just about to get another one.
Good.
Discounted,
I hope?
Yeah, I hope too. Yeah.
Good.
I guess I wonder, how does one weigh up just buying properties to let them out compared to doing joint ventures and doing things like that and weighing up the benefits or the...
Depends on your objective. So what is your objective? What do you want to achieve?
Initially, I haven't got a pension, so I'm thinking about my kids, there's a few of them, so where they're going to live and things
so
like
that. So for you, it's long-term ownership. At some point, as a property investor, you're going to run out of money. Have you run out of money yet?
No, I've got about 35,000 in some shares hanging around.
So you're going to run out of money on the next purchase?
Yes.
I don't mean this rudely at all.
No, no.
We all run out of money, all of us.
You don't want your business card anymore.
So at some point, every property investor runs out of money. Mm-hmm. It's part of the disease of being a property investor, I think. And therefore, at that point you've got a number of options. You run a, before you run out of money, you run a buy to sell strategy yourself.
Mm-hmm.
On average, we're taking 6 months to buy to sell, but I will tell everybody to count in 9 months in case the ruddy people drop out at the last minute. You have to put it back on the market and resell it. At the moment, things are going great, but 4 weeks ago, we just felt the beginnings of the balloon softening, the air going out the balloon. I think other people are feeling that as well. So I'm expecting the timescales to lengthen. So before you do last, because you're buying discounted, you can buy to sell. But then you do one, and then 6 months later, you get your money back, and then you do another one. It's pretty slow. So the second route is to borrow money and from people at a certain interest rate to do more. Make sure you're buying discounted, refinance, and pay them back out. No problem with that, as long as you make sure your figures are very, very safe. So we did 45 pieces of research, 5 estate agent valuations, 20 sold, and 20 currently on the market, and then do an average. And you're not really going to go wrong doing an average of 45 pieces of property as long as you don't BS yourself.
Mm-hmm.
Or the third is you do joint ventures buy to sell. Now, one of the beauties of joint ventures buy to sell is, so let's say you do Sam, sorry, but you're putting all the money in. So suddenly, although you've got a lot of activity costs, like your own costs, and for me, I've got a team, so my break-even point for my business is 40 grand a month. So we've got a fair amount of costs.
Mm-hmm.
You're not actually paying for the property or paying for the refurb. So you have a relatively light cash flow, and but then you're going to split the profit. We do it 50-50. So Sam does no work at all because you're storming in good, and you have very limited cash flow difficulties. And so now that's an infinitely scalable proposition, as long as you can get enough investors, and there are way more investors than deals, and you can run a good business. So really, for me, I am a keeper. Although we do a lot of buy to sell, I only sell to keep. I mean, very rarely does the selling money touch my bank account. I just say, keep it in your bank because I'm buying another one next week. You know, and it normally stays in the lawyer's bank account, goes straight back out to the next property.
Mm-hmm.
So for me, joint ventures is really a scalable proposition to allow cash flow not to kill an early, you know, I'm 5 years in as a limited company and 7 years in as an investor.
Mm-hmm.
So it doesn't kill your cash flow, because that's what puts people out of business.
Okay.
And it allows you to scale, but oh babe, every single second of that goes straight back into somebody's team.
So what kind of property you focus on? What kind of, is there a typical kind of property? You mentioned flats a bit.
Yes.
I mean, your houses.
Vanilla, 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 vanilla. I want life easy. And I also have I've been around enough properties that have gone pop to not want to do the credit. You know, maybe I'm a girl, so I don't need to chest bump, so I don't go chest bumpy. You know, we're now developing up some houses and we're building some houses, but basically we go in 6 to 8 week renovation, straight back out again. So we might take out the dining room to kitchen and put in a nice sofa for social reasons. Man and woman are both working these days. Their lifestyle is actually limited, isn't it? Because they're both working. So when are they going to socialize, have a chat, do the kids' homework and cook tea? All at the same time, which is why you've got the trendy open plan kitchen living room. It's actually a reduction in human life style, but it's sold as something hot. And then the other thing we'll do is put an ensuite in the master bedroom, but we are in and out ideally within 8 weeks and then back on the market. And also my price point is within what you might call the average a person's ability, or slightly larger than average person's ability to buy. And again, that's because I'm mitigating my risk. Like at any one time, we're doing about 30 buy to sells, and what if the market suddenly went? Now we can rent those out, no problem at all, but I don't want to be sat there selling £1 million houses. I want to be selling £300,000 houses, because my risk is mitigated.
Yeah.
So vanilla, all day long.
I'm just trying to understand a little bit your model a little bit more. I don't think I've quite got some of the basics. Are some of your investors people who get fixed interest deal, and some ones who are investing an equity share with an equity share in the gain, and you take whatever you take?
Pretty much. So the way I started.
So it was both.
Yeah, when I started, I had 60 grand in my own mortgage, and that was it. I had no intention of working with private investors at all. I was just going to buy a property. And then within 6 months of me starting, they put in the 6 month rule. Stinkers. And so at that point, I borrowed money with a straightforward interest rate. And then later on, because then I ran a sourcing business because I like property, so we sold deals to investors as well as I bought quite a lot myself because I was the biggest customer. And later on, we then said, hang on, we're running a sourcing business, we should do these as buy-to-sells. So then we really started a fairly significant joint venture buy-to-sell business. So both. I don't tend to mix, and I don't put two investors in the one deal because they don't know each other. You know, so it's like, shh, cats, you know. So both models work, and the kind of stats and the whole relationship build works for both models. Please do.
Like, what kind of strategy do you use for sourcing the discounts?
We have a lot of systems around this. So how many estate agents have you got? We've got 288, and Ash phones between 100 and 130 a week, every single week. Because we are the biggest buyer of secondhand houses in Bristol. We think, as in we've never heard of somebody who's buying more. There might be, they're just very quiet about it. Do you think they phone us? No. Because they're trained to sell a house to one person every 7 years, because on average we move every 7 years. So the fact that we buy a house a week isn't part of their comprehension. So yeah, he's got his favourites, and yes, people do call us up about deals, but basically he smashes out phone calls. We do landlord scraping, using them. This is a 2 second, which is again a whole weekend on how to source. So direct to estate agents, we phone 100 to 130 a week and do 30 viewings a week minimum, and he offers on 85% of every viewing, otherwise I'm kicking his ass. And we've worked together for 5 years now, and we've got a very good working relationship. Landlord scraping, so we get a chap called Jagaro, who's in Hyderabad in India, through upwork.com, to scrape landlord phone numbers on a Tuesday and a Thursday. So we scrape 100 landlord mobile numbers a week, goes into our spreadsheet. I've then got somebody in my team that phones them up and says, are you a owner, occupier, looking for a lodger, in which case ditch. Are you a letting agent, pretending to be a landlord, in which case ditch. If not, do you want to sell your property? Often they say no, sometimes they say yes, and then from then on out, we send them a text once a month to say, are your tenants driving you nuts? So direct to landlords, direct to mailbox. We pay somebody, now what nice job this is. We pay somebody to do an afternoon's worth walk a week, every single week. And on average, for an afternoon's walk, they find 12 new houses that are knackered. So the curtains are dirty, the windows are peeling, the front garden is knackered. Now that could be a tenanted property, but it's more often a house in the winter of its discontent. That goes onto our spreadsheet, and we write 1,200 letters, January, February, March, April, May. Told you it's fast. And we batch them out. We've got 1,000 of them go out in January, 1,000 go out in February, 1,000 go out in March. So at some point, that house will need to be sold. And then I don't really like leafleting, because I found it really distressing. You get the best discounts, but I found the scenarios and situations, sometimes I've had gorgeous, gorgeous, gorgeous moments of buying direct from vendor. Really lovely, really happy moments. Normally, you're in the murk of someone's misery, and that just isn't my cup of tea. But we used to spend £4,000 a month leafleting, and then we'd be buying direct from vendor. So you can do that too. Now, if you're going to do that, you don't want, like, you know, death, destruction, misery, divorce, disaster. You know, how fast is that leaflet going to stay on your fridge? You know, that is embarrassing. So what you do is you do, I'm sorry about this, I don't really like, there's nothing wrong with it as long as you behave ethically, but, you know, death, destruction, divorce, disaster, are you in trouble? But what you do is, what's useful to somebody? So is it fish and chip shops? Is it hairdressers? Is it CPR that you must make sure is correct, you know, from the NHS? Is it the calendar? Is it, you know, do you get people to sponsor you and actually pay for your leafleting? And you do a tiny little thing there, and you say, stick this on my fridge. And then a tiny little thing saying, Weaver houses, please turn over.